Hey there. Ever been down a rabbit hole? Well, today I'm going to take you down the deepest, darkest rabbit hole I've ever descended. Computer numerical control. Just a quick warning, the subject matter in this video may forever change your perception of hobbies, put an end to any kind of social life you thought you might have had, and burn a hole in your wallet so big a three-phase spindle and VFD could fit right through it. At least that's been my experience. I think what drew me and all the rest of us to this particular creative art was the allure of an escape from the mundane. Too many times have I had to drill hundreds of holes one by one in some kind of zombie state. Winding handles and pulling levers felt primitive when the promise of automation hung just within sight. Well, enough was enough. It was time to break free. Now, I'm not an engineer, but you don't need a degree to know that bigger equals better. The weight of your machine directly affects its resonant frequency, which can have a huge impact on things like surface finish, tool life, and your self-esteem. Likewise, the placement and distance between bearing components will affect the final stiffness of your machine. I tried my best to maximize these aspects of the mill, while at the same time, minimizing its footprint in relation to its travel. I decided a C-frame configuration, built from flat bar and the largest RHS I could get my hands on, would give me the best chance of success on all fronts. I added internal gussets to the machine frame to improve the torsional stiffness, and some pads on the bottom to create a reference plane for all later machining operations. Adding holes to the pads was the only hope I'd have of fixturing the basin column to the mill table, as both sections completely covered the T-slots. Where possible, by using high-strength epoxy and bolts instead of welding, I tried to avoid introducing stresses that might warp the critical surfaces during machining. As a bonus, the epoxy sandwich helps with vibrations through a phenomenon known as conformal damping. I added shims to the joints to make sure there was a place for the epoxy to live once I'd tightened all the bolts down. The irony of drilling and hand tapping all those holes after that preamble is not lost on me. And would you look at that? Those pads look like they'll be the perfect spot for the ball screw. Once I had everything glued up, I could machine the bearing and ball screw mounting surfaces. There was a bit of back and forth to get everything to the same height and coplanar, but I did all right, considering I was using 110% of the mill's travel. Unfortunately, the bearing mounting surfaces ended up with a slight arch, around 0.1 of a millimeter over 600 millimeters, due to the table sagging at the far ends of its travel. I would have liked to scrape them in, but finding metrology equipment in Australia is about as hard as finding metrology equipment in Australia. I also cut the screws to length and machined the end to fit the floating mount. Making the intermediary plates for each axis was just a matter of milling flats, drilling holes, and tapping threads until everything fit together nicely. Here, you can see me doing a proper deburring. This was only after I'd been reminded, yet again, what I look like on the inside. By the way, If you like the video, go ahead and like the video. And if you hit subscribe, I'll know you want to see more. Once I'd repeated the drilling, tapping, gluing, and machining on the column, I could weld on the base plate. Using shims and tactical tacking, as square to the y-axis as I could get it, I welded the column in position. When it's time for the final assembly, I'll epoxy the mating surfaces and true the column with the three jack screws on the base plate. Next up was the table. I'd already decided to have the table surface ground. Having a really flat surface was essential, both as a reference surface for assembling the machine and throughout its use. I decided to have the X-axis rails mounted to the underside of the bed, which is upside down compared to a lot of other builds I've seen. Intuitively, this should be more rigid, as it keeps the bearing blocks as close to the tool as possible. But again, I'm not an engineer. Having bolted and glued the table together, I sent it off to the grinders. In the meantime, I started on the spindle bridge. Out of 32mm square bar, I fabricated a frame, which was then filled in and reinforced with 10mm plate. This hole saw was not having a good time, but I managed to cut the spindle mounting hole and bore it out to 90mm. The design incorporates tram adjustment for the X direction through this pivoting plate. Tram in the Y direction is achieved by tilting everything beyond that plate around this bolt. I couldn't resist a test run. This thing is heavy, which means it's time for the counterweight. A chain attaches to the back of the main Z-axis plate, then runs up and over the column to the counterweight. I mean, you know how a counterweight works, right? Okay, we're getting close now. I got the table back from the surface grinders and wow, what an awesome result. This thing exudes flatness. Of course, I don't really have the tools to measure how flat it is, but it looks flat. And then it was time for paint. If you couldn't tell by the lack of footage, by this stage my excitement had really gotten the better of me. I started off with a zinc primer and followed up with a custom mix of silver hammer tone, blue pigment, and too much thinners. Don't forget to wear your respirator. In the end, I couldn't be happier with the colour. It might even look like a real machine when it's done. And so, having completed the machine frame, it was time to load it in the boot of my ever-patient partner's car and bring it home.
So what are you going to use it for?
What's that? What's that? What's that?